This is DJ Asclepius, and welcome to Podcasts and Poetry. This is the part of our program where we shine the spotlight on the creative talent in our very own Shroud of the Avatar community. So just sit back and relax for some wonderful stories, poems, and music. Yes, and welcome everybody. It's time again for Podcast and Poetry, some wonderful stories from our Shroud of the Avatar community. It's also time for prizes. Now, if you'd like to win a streamer bundle, then all you have to do is come on down to the Avatars Radio Studio in Immortal City. You can find it pretty easily. The first person to open a trade window with Elaine Dragonfire in the next half hour wins a streamer bundle. Ain't that great? So, look, one bundle per avatar per day, please. And there you go. Come on down and win. Let's get on with the stories. Here we go. Hello, everyone. This is Asclepius with a wonderful story from Wombi entitled The Strange Case of Thaddeus Mange. Background music by Smart Sound. It was around a year ago that Thaddeus Mange, long-term resident of Kingsport, disappeared with nary a trace. Nobody thought too much of it at the time. What with the rise of bandits, the newly encroaching undead, and the loss of shipping contact with Novia, residents of Kingsport had other things on their minds. What did attract their attention, however, was the gradual disappearance of his house. Piece by piece, item by item, parts of his dwelling have been mysteriously disappearing. Naturally, thieves were blamed, and the local guard Douglas kept watch. To his disbelief and horror, items appeared to walk off and vanish before his very eyes, resulting in him locking himself securely in the watchtower at night. Soon, these strange disappearances became public knowledge, and, as is often the case when the ignorant are confronted with the inexplicable, his neighbours formed a cult. Naturally, this cult interpreted the disappearances as a message, although the exact nature of the message was the cause of much argument within the cult. A split formed between those who believed that the disappearance foretold a final cataclysmic end of the world, the Enders, and those who interpreted the disappearance as a sign that all avatars would one day suddenly vanish, the Avatarians. Disagreement between these two factions has recently turned violent, with both sides fighting for possession of the site. Meanwhile, Thaddeus Mange has almost completed the transfer of his house from the Hidden Vale to Novia by rowboat, and hopes to move the last few items any day now. He uses an invisibility spell and works at night, so as to avoid having to talk with his neighbours, whom he cannot stand. And there you are, that's the story. Okay, now next we have another great item. As you are aware, we are serialising and broadcasting this wonderful story by Lily Bird, the Stone Dragon series. It's a thrilling chronicle, and it's going to go on for some time because it's a very large book, but we are all taking it in turns to narrate it. Chapter 8 is upcoming, and this one is narrated by Amber Rain. Here it is.
Creeping quietly down the seemingly endless tunnel in the dim illumination from the main passageway above by feeling along the slimy walls with their hands took all the concentration that any of them had. No one wanted to be the one to stumble and make noise that would be heard below. They had doused their torches. At this point in the dark, going ever downward didn't seem to be quite the brightest idea anyone had had. Each step led closer to a battle that none of them wanted to have, especially not deep in a mine tunnel against trolls. Dirt. That's almost all anyone could smell. The grit of it got between their teeth, and everyone could feel it choking them if they breathed too deeply. And it was dank. Shallow breathing was the only deterrent to feeling as if they had taken in a pail full of wet dirt. Dirty and dank. Oh, and dark. Especially in the dark. Their torches left with the packs in the tunnel above. Zyrena shuddered. The unknown dark brought old memories of the world she had escaped, and new fears of the dark places she had encountered in this world. And she didn't have difficulty breathing shallowly. She held on until the images from the past finished flashing into her consciousness. Those old experiences might help her keep alert to danger, but they were not this dark passageway heading towards the trolls, and she needed to stay focused on what was right in front of her, even if she couldn't see it. She had avoided trolls since that incident in the mountains years ago, and was not looking forward to repeating the experience, even though she was a far better shot with her arrows than she had been when she first arrived. The tunnel went on and on. Just as she was going to call everyone back and try a different tunnel, she could sense the ground underneath level out. The others had gathered in a huddle ahead, whispering. "There's a cave. I can smell trolls," Torjan whispered hoarsely. "Torjan, you go in first and get their attention. Zyrena will follow." Phlebas nodded at her as she joined the group. "I will be right behind Zyrena, and Lucy can follow me." He lit a small spark of light into the palm of his hand with a quickly spoken magic phrase, then paused to look around the ancient faces. "All right?"
"Yep. Okay. Sure."
There was a troll just inside the cave entrance that threw great boulders which wobbled the ground. It swung a massive axe over its head and struck at Torjan over and over, missing by a hair's breadth as he ducked and rolled away from the blows each time. Torjan indeed had its full attention. He led it on a merry chase near the entrance, teasing it even as he did so. "Come on, you big lout." Zyrena peppered it with her arrows as soon as she emerged from the dark tunnel into the dimly lit cave and could see her target. She too danced in a circle following Torjan while he baited the troll. Phlebas stepped just inside the entrance and began reciting a spell while the power of his words manifest as a ball of energy between his outstretched hands. Lucy crouched near Phlebas, chanting the words to spells of healing that were directed to Torjan and Zyrena, wrapping them in a protective continuous healing warmth. Then without warning, Torjan's voice changed from teasing to an order. "Jump!" Not understanding Torjan's order was for her benefit, Zyrena didn't jump and soon found herself frozen in place by a stunning strike the troll managed to land that affected everyone who was in touch with the ground. Afterward, when she unfroze, it took nearly a half a minute for her to regain control over herself again. Her entire body had been rigid while she fought to free herself. When she finally did, she shook her head to clear it before stepping back a few paces, trying to get out of range. She saw both Lucy and Phlebas also regain their own control after being stunned, and they began casting again. As their spells had been interrupted by the stun. "Jump!" Torjan called out again. Zyrena jumped as the troll's blow hit the ground again. This time she did not get stunned, and from that point forward listened carefully for Torjan's voice among the clashing and bashing of axe and hammer. Meanwhile, she continued to pepper the troll with shot after shot of arrows tipped in the poisonous fires. Just as the troll they were fighting seemed to weaken and buckle, another one came into sight. Then there were two more, and the group was fully engaged in new fight, even as the first troll fell. These were all small trolls, thankfully. Zyrena had seen a full-grown one before, and could tell the difference in the troll's strength and size from the full-grown one, even in the gloom in the cave. Regardless of their size, each of these small trolls could easily snap any one of their spines in a second if they were caught and were utterly trying to do just that. She saw Torjan take a blow that would have killed her. The troll threw him across the cave and he lay still for a moment while she shouted and got the troll's attention, before Zyrena saw him jump up and run back into the fray. Lucy was fully occupied casting spell after healing spell to keep both Torjan and Zyrena alive during the onslaught. Phlebas had managed casting without interruption long enough between jumps to create a fire ring on the floor of the cave that Torjan led the trolls into time and time again. The fire ring did not affect Torjan at all, but the trolls were not having as much success in the ring.
The fire there seemed to melt them, and they dropped like snowmen in a lava pit. I didn't know you could do that. Lucy looked over at Phlebas, who was breathing heavy and sweating from his effort. He nodded, but didn't speak. More, back here. Zyrena's shouted warning came in time for Phlebas to cast and release yet another burning ring of fire for Torjan and Zyrena to lead the three trolls into, with their teasing dance, arrows, and axe blows. One of these was a full-grown troll. It was twice the size of the others and twice as difficult to kill, but it moved slower, and somehow Zyrena and Torjan managed to stay out of the grasp of the unexpectedly agile smaller trolls and avoid the large one, and far more deadly one. This time, the stroke went on far longer than any of them had thought they could manage to fight, and yet they did not break or come to more harm than Lucy could swiftly dissipate with her healing magic. In the end, there were 5 very dead trolls in the cave, and 4 sweaty and exhausted humans catching their breath. Well, that was fun! Torjan looked rejuvenated after their effort, and grinned from ear to ear, still swung his axe just with pleasure of hearing the swish as it arced through the air. Phlebas sank to the ground horrified and exhausted by the fighting. His experiences with causing death had been mostly academic in the last decade, and before that, most of the killing had been done by Zyrena, with her bow and arrows. Being directly responsible for the death of another being, even one as dangerous and vile as a troll, took a toll on Phlebas. After checking everyone carefully for injuries and healing the last superficial wounds from the clash, while Zyrena and Sorgen were occupied in claiming treasures from the dead troll's fifth pocket, Lucy lit her torch and wandered around the edge of the cave, until she discovered a smaller cave tucked behind a rock, screened deep inside the massive cave where they had fought the trolls. Hey, I think I found the room John was mentioning in his last testament. It was a smaller cave indeed, and crammed with all sorts of things for experimentation. Near the entrance was a prison cell, which held only a human skeleton. Throughout the room were several vats of humans suspended in some sort of fluid. No one could make out if they were sleeping or dead. An operating table was in the right, with knives, saws, books, and various potions displaying there. Nearing the back, on a large desk with a pencil obsidian-style chair, with its jutting lines and uncomfortable seat, were a stack of journals and papers. Something fluttered by, and Zyrena ducked automatically. Bats, she muttered to herself. Of course there are bats. Once inside, Zyrena stared back at the entrance to the bigger cave, with her bow drawn. She was convinced they were not safe back in this small area after the fierce battle. Were there more trolls? Were they coming? The others could go look through the books and papers to find out what this place was used for. She was going to guard the doorway. Torjan found himself staring at the bones of someone in a prison cell on a cot, and the discarded skin of a young green dragon on the floor. He didn't know what it meant, but it gave him a pain in the pit of his stomach that made him want to harm whoever had been experimenting and torturing living beings here in the dark, dank cave. Lucy moved around the room, reading the papers and experiment books, trying to make sense of what was obviously some sort of lab. On a work table, Lucy found and read aloud the record of the latest experiment. Oh, listen, she recited. The creation of a human dragon. Out of the young dragon hatched from one of the viable northern Drakenfield eggs, procured for the Cabal and Marek Dugan, the human subject. What? Torgan looked shaken. Lucy continued, we have failed to produce a dragon with a controllable human mind, and all we manage is a human with a dragon mind. The human dragon, who calls himself Marek Dragon, refuses to follow the simplest instructions and is far too independent of a thinker to become any sort of tool we can use in the Southern Branch. We have no control over him. The experiment is a failure. Even the Dugan family liches didn't recognize him any longer. When they attacked, he was no help to us at all. Torjan's skin whitened as he heard what had been done to Marek. Torjan, who was still examining the dragon skin, spoke. So, this skin and that skeleton are the leftovers from combining the human and the dragon? Isn't Marek Dugan the owner's son of the inn upstairs? After nodding, Phlebas took over, reading out of a journal he had picked up while listening to Lucy. The human retained its dragon memories, and its human ones too. After several experiments, the dragon human continues to insist on being called Marek Dragon. He has no memory of how he came to be. The matter is out of our hands now, as he escaped months ago. The Dugan family liches rose up and attacked him shortly after the experiments on Merrick began, and he fled into confusion. Asclepius thoughtfully added, "The Dugan family liches apparently took exception to their family member Merrick Dugan being used in an experiment. I'm betting that's why they rose up from the crypt in the first place." Lucy took over with another entry. "Listen to this. Yesterday, while we were in the room of magical casting trying to revive that old dragon leg bone we took from the Jade Valley graveyard into an undead version of itself, we were attacked again. Viciously." She quoted, "The liches attacked without warning, disrupting our magical spell today, and they took over the room of conjuring. We were forced back here to the room of experimentation. We have hired trolls to guard the outer cave and to protect our work from these liches attacking her again, as we were barely able to survive their first attack. The trolls don't seem to care who they kill, and it has been a struggle even to get in and out of our own room here." Phlebas read, "However, while displacing us from the room of casting, they have stolen the tome of magic we were using, and we go to retrieve it from the lich stronghold in our room of casting. We need that book to complete our work, and do not want Nestor to know we've lost control here." "And now liches have the book," Cyrena summed up, not having taken her eyes off the entrance to the room they were exploring. Lucy was still reading and started to summarize what she was finding. "There is another notation here from a red branch mage that says liches have attacked and stolen the tome containing the secret obsidian magic spell they had been using. Another dragon had been summoned to try to link with another volunteer human, but the link broke when the liches burst in and killed everyone and took over the room of casting where the magic book lay beside the dragon bone." She looked up at Cyrena. "Do you think that's the dragon we faced at the graveyard last night?" "Considering the timing, I'd say yes," Cyrena still didn't look away from the door. It was as if she didn't trust the trolls that they had defeated to stay dead. "I want to know where that room of casting is located." "As do I," Phlebas agreed as he scanned the journals on the desk for more information. Lucy went on from her readings. "There were few survivors from the lich attack. Those of us left are desperate to recover the tome, because the spell to summon a dragon from bone of a dead one had been successful. The dragon bone had been forming, and its completion only thwarted by yesterday's attack of angry liches, and theft of the magic tome containing the spell. We're determined to recover the tome, and I write just before we leave to get it, and our room of casting back from them. There are no directions to location of the lich stronghold, except to say, further into the tunnels, which doesn't help us much," Phlebas muttered. "We've got to recover that spellbook before the Southern Red Branch take it back from the liches." Lucy was firm, and she was determined. In her eyes, enough innocent living beings had been lost to these experiments. Cyrena nodded. So did Jordan and Phlebas. Lucy continued to collect samples of mushrooms she had found growing near the dark edges of the small cave. Phlebas took some time to review everything they had learned, so that everything was clear in his mind before he spoke again. "So, as far as I understand, the Dugan ancestors, now liches themselves, seem to have risen when Merrick Dugan, their direct descendant, was experimented upon a few months ago. And that's when they killed all the visitors to the mine, as well as attacking these mages from the Southern Red Branch." "Yes, that's right," Cyrena nodded. "The liches attacked everyone, even Merrick, after he was changed because they no longer recognized him as their own blood." "Then," Phlebas took up the thread of events again, "liches attacked again and interrupted a magic casting and stole the magic book that the Southern Red Branch mages had been using to recreate obsidian spells, as well as claiming the room referred to as the Room of Casting." Torjan spoke then. "The liches were protecting their family the only way they knew how, by keeping the Tome of Magic from anyone. They're not likely to hand it over to us either." "How did the trolls get here?" Phlebas didn't want to ask, but he needed to know. Lucy added, after straightening up from her labors, "I read a scroll over there that discussed that. These trolls were brought to the cave by the elven mages themselves, from some other stronghold of theirs. It wasn't named. They were brought to guard the entrance to the experiment room after the first lich attacked some months previous." It all seemed to make sense to Phlebas now, but he was still unclear why anyone had turned to stone. There was a far deeper mystery here than he suspected, but was beginning to understand that the magic book was central to all the horror. Who is Nestor? Torjan brought up a point the others had nearly overlooked. Lucia and Cyrena both shrugged. I don't know yet, Torjan, but the Southern Red Branch mages need to be chased away from Jade Valley, regardless of who they report to. I'm betting whatever is affecting the animals and people in this valley is directly related to them being here. He repeated, we're going to have to take the book from them and take back these tunnels and rooms for the Dugan family. Cleavis was grim, but decided. Let's go! Torjan seemed eager to leave the room. He was still staring at the dragon skin and skeleton of Merica Dugan, and didn't seem to be able to shake the horror from his eyes. He could not fight this kind of evil, and he felt helpless in the face of what had happened here. There was nothing he could do to change anything, and he was not used to the feelings of helpless bystander in any situation. It shook him to the core of his beliefs. It sounds like the mages are still ahead of us. If they have indeed left to reclaim the ruined castle, so beware. We might come upon the mages in the tunnel, or worse, liches, Cyrena continued. And we don't know where the lich holdout is, but it has to be down these tunnels somewhere. Remember that map on the bulletin board when we first arrived down here in the mines? Phlebas reminded them. There was a chamber discovered that was marked along that main passage we had been in before coming down here. It's to the left, near the end, that we have not yet come to. Maybe we can start there? Everyone was in agreement. With that, Torjan led the tired group back up through the long, dark, dank tunnel to the main corridor, far above this horror, turning to the left when he reached the passage.
Yankovic, and you're listening to Avatars Radio. Oh, really, really, really lame. Lame,
lame, lame, the same. Black Rose Chronicles, Chapter 14. Making her way out of Kingsport, she saw vast lands before her. From what she could hear in the conversations in the tavern, there were several towns dotted around the massive island. Many boats were anchored on the shorelines, and she could see smaller islands off in the distance. Turning around, she saw massive groves of trees and even a swampy area along the coast. This should make for some interesting exploration. Right outside Kingsport proper, there was a huge galleon ship, assuming it only takes me back where she came from. Then, a few strides away, were a couple of smaller towns. Heading to the west along the coast, she walked to the gate of one of these towns. This would be a good start. The sign at the gate said Silverston. As she walked across the bridge, the centre of the town looked pleasing. Central crafting area with all she needed to use. Vendors along the edges to buy what wares would be needed. Tavern that looked promising for a hot meal and drink. There were several row houses staggered along the walkways that seemed to be occupied, and several along the river's edge as well. Further back, there was a most beautiful home she assumed was the mayor's house. Fountains and other buildings dotted the area. For some reason, as she took in the sights, she felt at ease. A sort of peace fell over her. After a few moments, a kind-looking gentleman and another more regal figure appeared walking down the cobblestone pathway. They both looked up at the same time and saw Bella standing there looking about. Gently, she pulled her backpack from her shoulder and sat it at her feet as the two men approached. Then one man smiled brightly and outstretched his hand. Welcome! Welcome to Silverston. My name is Andrew Silverston, and this is my town. I see you have that look of a well-travelled sort. The other gentleman gave a slight cough and smile behind his hand.
Thank you, kind sirs. Yes, I have travelled quite a bit over the last month or so. Came all the way from Soul Town.
The more regal gentleman offered his hand and introduced himself. Aye, are you one of the outlanders that have arrived in Soul Town? My name is Astor Cerberus. She looked the man up and down. His demeanour was casual and not offensive.
Yes, sir. I arrived from the sea by way of some vortex. I have lost my ship and crew along the way. I hope to one day find some of them if they survived.
Both men shook their heads and then took her by the arms gently. The regal one hoisted her pack on his shoulder and they led her to the tavern. Let's go into the tavern and have a pint while you tell us your tale, winking at Astor. And we might tell you our tales as well, for we too are, or once were, outlanders as well. She let them lead her to the tavern, and for the first time since he had arrived in this strange land, she felt safe and well met. This might just be a good place to set down roots, as she had the feeling she would be here for a long while. Sitting at the table with a pint of ale in hand, she regaled the men with her story. They both nodded often at the things she said. Once she was done, they chimed in as well, often repeating things she had said. They too had similar experiences. They talked about the area and what they had been doing for what seemed like, to them, ages. They both agreed that for their troubles and adventuring they had amassed some wealth and established themselves. Clearing his throat, Astor spoke up first. I have been all over the lands and currently live in Baron's Reach. It's a nice place and I have many a friend there, but I would like to settle in my own town for a change. Master Silverstone here has gotten an itchy foot and wishes to travel, so he has offered to sell his fine village to me for a reasonable fee. With that comment, he winked at Andrew, and they both chuckled. If you are of a mind to settle, my lady, we, or should I say Astor, would love to have you take up residence here. Smiling at the gentleman, she nodded, and from there they discussed the costs and such to gain a home in the town. After a few more months of travelling about Hidden Vale, she had gained the funds to purchase a plot of land. Small to start out with, but was enough for her. With tools in hand, she cleared the parcel and set about gathering the materials she would need to build her first home. Tired, dirty and sore for most of the time, she was pleased to have busy work to keep her mind occupied. Something other than rescuing folk and killing the evil in the lands, although the latter part was always present. With the crafting tables in the middle of town, it was easy to do what she needed, and her little spot by the river was just perfect for her. Bella had met many a folk in Hidden Vale, and even in the small town she now lived in. She helped others gain wood and stone to build their own homes. And as new travellers found their way into town, she aided them as well. It was becoming quite a bustling town, so much that Astor decided to expand the town. And that is where Night's Watch came into existence. She was pleased with the name, as it seemed fitting. The town sitting seaside faced outwards to the horizon, and they could watch as ships came in and out when they happened to do so. A lot of trade ships were few and far between lately. Apparently the unrest across the lands had caused problems on the water as much as on land. As they sat around the tavern one evening, her and a few of her friends in the town decided they would work together to thwart the lands of the madness. They all agreed, and she formed a guild of her friends. They then became the Keepers of the Watch. Fitting name, for sure. As the town grew, so did the guild. Standing on the docks one evening, Astor was watching out across the waters. Bella approached and clapped him on the back.
Master Cerberus, 'tis a fine evening, don't you think? Not turning to look her way, he smiled and nodded. Yes, indeed. They stood there for a fine long time, watching as the sun set on the horizon. Turning towards town, he started telling her what he had planned for the town and asked if she would be interested in becoming a steward and helping out. Stopping, she looked at him and smiled, extended her hand, and there they shook in agreement. First building was the Guild and Magistrate building by the stone bridge, easily seen from the docks and the bridge. Here they would conduct their guild and town business. This pleased her very much. Just outside the hall there were wagons that could ferry folk to neighbouring towns like Kingsport and other smaller villages about. On the docks, once shored up a bit and more stable, there were also transport ships to some of the island towns around Hidden Vale. Things were definitely looking up for Night's Watch. So many new folk were coming into town, Asta decided to place some row houses along the dockside. He called it a promenade. He always liked using fancy words. Here he hired vendors to sell the residents' wares and also offered temporary housing for those who did not yet have the means to build their own homes. It was all working out for sure. Standing high on one of the rises in the back of town, Bella looked out over the sprawling landscape. Houses dotted the scene all about. Dirk Blackpool had claimed the land on the small island at the lake. Others had claimed spots within town. To make room for more homes in town, Asta had built an elegant Shogun crafting pavilion to hold all the crafting stations. It was wondrous to see when you walked through the clock tower from the docks and thriving promenade. The vendors were often busy there now, and it was nice to see more folk come to town and visit. With the boats and wagons, commerce picked up a bit from Kingsport. Many adventurers found their way to Night's Watch. She smiled as she saw a ship come into the bay. One day, she thought to herself, one day she will find her ship, or better yet, build another Black Rose and sail around this new land she had started calling home. She knew she would never make it back to where she came from. It weighed heavy on her heart that her family was still there, and she had no way to let them know she was all right. And there was no way for her to get back. Often she missed the old lands, friends, and her family. But she was making new friends, and her guildmates have become her new family. With that thought in mind, she made her way down the path and back into the town. She had a task at hand, and had strayed from it for long enough. And that's another great story from Belladonna Rose that we are gradually unfolding. So I hope you're enjoying following along. Okay, it is now prize time again, people. Aland Dragonfire is giving away streamer bundles, which are pretty worthwhile. All you have to do is get yourself to the Avatars Radio Studio, which is in Mistrinder, which is in Immortal City, just off the coast of Mistrinder. The first one here in the next half hour to open a trade window with Alain will win a streamer bundle, and that is awesome. We have given away one already. Congratulations, Treasure Pile, for the first winner of the day. So we'll see who comes up next. Okay, and we will be giving away more prizes as the broadcast goes on.
Red alert. Battle stations. Red alert. Battle stations. Red alert. Battle stations. Red alert, battle stations. Red alert, battle stations.
You're listening to Podcast and Poetry on Avatars Radio, Radio of the Avatars. The New Britannia Theatre Troupe presents Conversations in Paxlair. Written by Wombi. Produced and directed by Asclepius. Music supervisor and director of public relations, Amber Rain.
Red alert, battle stations.
And technical director, Sir Style Teckle. Voice cast, Dr. Shroud as Harry, Lord Baldrith as Fred, Lady Adnor as Citizen 1, Asclepius as Citizen 2, Cordelin Valcaris as Guard, Sophie as Christine, Jinx as Oracle Agent, Amber Rain as Sarah, and Asclepius as the narrator. Every day, the market square in Paxlair is a bustling centre of activity. Stallholders stand ready to sell their wares, trying to catch the attention of passers-by. However, what seems a typical day at the market, with innocent and hard-working merchants, can be something quite different beneath the surface. Let us listen in for a moment to the adventures of three such merchants. Fred and Harry are at their stalls, chatting to each other in between selling priceless treasures to customers. Sarah, at an adjoining stall, is quietly going about her business.
Fresh fish, get your fresh fish here. Caught this morning in Spindrift Bay. Look into their eyes and see how fresh they are.
A well-dressed lady approaches Harry's stall and catches his eye.
You, madam, one glance at your impressive attire tells me that you have exquisite taste. It is so refreshing to encounter a person of such refinement. Only one such as yourself could possibly have a palate sufficiently refined to appreciate the delicate flavours of my exclusive produce. Take these extremely rare Wobbegon fillets, for example, caught fresh this morning.
I'm not familiar with Wobbegon. What breed of fish is that?
I'm not surprised that you have not heard of it, madam, for it is an extremely rare delicacy and dangerous to capture. This very catch took the lives of 2 fishermen. Naturally, when I heard of this, I immediately brought the catch and notified a certain gentleman who lives on a hill not far from here. Professional discretion, of course, prevents me from revealing his name, but he has a standing order for any items of exceptional rarity and taste that I secure. He will be serving Wobbegon as the main course at his banquet this evening. Fortunately for you, I kept 4 fillets with the intention of surprising my wife. Sadly, she was unexpectedly called away to tend to her sick mother. I am therefore prepared to part with them for a mere 500 gold apiece. That is considerably less than I received from a certain gentleman whose name I cannot mention, but you impress me and I am prepared to let them go at cost.
Well, I do feel like I deserve something a little special. All right, I will take your remaining fillets.
As his customer departs, Harry turns to Fred.
Where was I? Oh yes. So anyhow, there I was, hiding in the wardrobe, hurriedly putting on my pants, when Dagnar comes racing up the stairs and bursts into the room, accusing his wife of infidelity. I can hear him noisily searching everywhere while he berates his wife, so I open the wardrobe door and wave to him. While he's standing there, looking half-furious, half-confused, I say, "Ah, thank goodness you've arrived. The Oracle has an important job for you."
You certainly like to live dangerously, Fred. What happened next?
Well, fortunately, Dagner's curiosity overcame his anger, and rather than attacking me, he paused, saying, "What is the meaning of this? You have 5 seconds to explain yourself before I turn you into sausage meat."
A man wanders through the marketplace and pauses in front of Fred's stall.
"Good morning, sir. Can I interest you in the freshest produce in the entire Vale? Just this morning we received a rare, limited shipment of these incredible new Doric seeds, which are selling fast. I suggest you act quickly if you don't want to miss out."
"What's a Doric?"
"You haven't heard? The plant they grow into produces incredible fruit. They are unlike anything you've ever tried before, and they keep for ages, an ideal snack at more refined parties, or they can be used as a nutritious, lightweight provision on long journeys."
"Can you show me their fruit?"
"If only I could. Sadly, the fruit are always sold out within minutes of obtaining a new supply. If someone were to plant and harvest these, I would pay good money for a steady supply. I would do it myself, but sadly, I do not own land."
How much for your entire collection of seeds?"
"The entire collection? Well, I guess I could let them go for 1,000 gold, but I would be very reluctant to do so. I would need a guarantee that I would get first refusal on the purchase of any fruit that they produce."
"Yeah, that seems fair. Agreed. Here you go." As the customer departs, Fred turns back to Harry.
"So, what happened next?"
"Well, as you know, Dagnar is not the sharpest tool in the shed, so I turned to him and said, 'What I am about to tell you is top secret information, and I can only reveal it if you agree to assist the Oracle in an operation of the utmost secrecy and importance.' Naturally, he wasn't about to turn down what he thought was a direct request from the Oracle, so he nodded in acquiescence. I then asked if he agreed to serve the Oracle faithfully and without question, and never to reveal anything that he learned in her service. Dagnar replied, 'I do,' at which point I told him that the occupant of the row house next door was a member of a banned obsidian group and was no doubt plotting an insurrection. I told him that I was one of two operatives that the Oracle intended to place in row houses on either side of the subject's home, and that Dagnar's wardrobe was ideally placed to enable me to observe him. Naturally, I would need access to the wardrobe during the day so that I could observe the subject using a small hole drilled through the wall. I added that the Oracle would look favorably on him for providing assistance in this matter.
He bought it?
Hook, line, and sinker. To this day, I regularly visit his wife while he is away at work and provide him with frequent updates on the progress of the evil obsidian plot. Speaking of evil plots, Harry, did you ever discover why the house next door to yours is haunted?
Indeed. A rather odd tale it is. As you know, the sounds from that house have been keeping me up for weeks. Since it is at the end of the street and thus has no other neighbors, I have been the only one to suffer. Getting a local guard to take an interest proved fruitless, so I decided to investigate on my own.
And to think, only a few minutes ago you accused me of living dangerously. Go on.
Well, since the house has been unoccupied for years, I figured the chances of the owner turning up were minimal. I forced the window to gain entry. The front room was pitch dark, and I dared not use a light spell for fear of attracting a passing guard. Fortunately, all these row houses share an identical layout, so I began to slowly feel my way up the stairs. It was at that moment that I heard an eerie sound that woken me every night for weeks, coming from the top floor.
At this point, a guard enters, walking purposefully to Harry's stall. He is accompanied by a mature woman who is dabbing her eyes with a handkerchief.
Greetings, citizen. How may I help you this fine day? I have only the freshest fish for sale, caught this morning in Spindrift Bay. Look into their eyes and see how fresh they are.
Is this the one?
Yes, that's him. He used to have a stall in Owl's Head till he was chased out of town. This is the evil snake who promised to marry my daughter and then skipped town with the dowry.
What do you have to say for yourself, citizen?
Ah, Roland. I love my identical twin brother dearly, but he leads a troubled life. I have tried many times to place him on the right path, but I fear that we are destined to be complete opposites. Why, only last week, as I was donating food to the poor, I thought of him. I wondered if there was not some way that I had overlooked whereby I could have steered him towards the path of virtue.
Ha! What a preposterous tale. Only an idiot would believe you have an identical twin brother. There is no doubting that you are the despicable cad who broke the heart of my poor, weeping daughter. It's a tragedy that in this so-called enlightened metropolis, being the rear end of a kobold is not a capital offense.
I have an identical twin brother. He is a great disappointment to the family.
Please believe me, lady, when I tell you how mortified I am that your poor daughter has been yet another victim of my despicable brother. Much as it pains me to say this, I really hope that he can be caught and punished before he brings more misery to this world.
I know how you feel. My brother Reginald has done untold damage to our family name. Please, let me know if you hear of Roland's whereabouts.
The guard nods curtly at Harry and starts to walk away.
What? You believed that drivel? Come back and arrest the lying scoundrel!
Christine wrings her hands in frustration and hurries off after the guard.
I believe you were ascending the stairs. Please continue.
Indeed. After cautiously inching my way up the stairs, I eventually reached the top floor. With each step, the sound had been growing louder. But as I reached the top of the stairs, it suddenly stopped. The door to the front room was open, and a thin shaft of moonlight forced its way through a dirty broken window, allowing me to barely discern some vague shapes. I tiptoed towards the room from whence I was certain the sound had come. Reaching the door, I peered inside. In the far corner of the room, I could see a dark, huddled shape with a single glowing eye. Gathering my courage, I forced myself to approach that strange beast. And it was then I discovered the true nature of my nightly tormentor.
Go on.
It was an 8-foot vibration amplifier sitting on the bedside table. A small rodent had taken up residence inside, and its nocturnal ventures occasionally switched the device on or off. Since it was not turned to a station, the result was a strange hissing sound that had been waking me up at night.
Great story, Harry. Terrific climax. Now I know how your wife feels. Anyhow, there goes the sun. Shall we pack up and adjourn to Wodey's?
Of course. Why should today be any different from every other day?
Harry and Fred pack up their wares and head off toward Wodey's Tavern, chuckling as they go. Meanwhile, a mysterious person approaches Sarah's stall.
The Oracle needs a report, Agent Sarah.
As directed, I have observed the behavior of Fred and Harry. It appears that Fred has been spreading misinformation about the Oracle, and I overheard him mention an obsidian plot. Harry has been breaking and entering houses in Paxlair.
Excellent work, Agent Sarah. I think they both warrant closer scrutiny. They may very well be instigators of a serious plot against the Oracle. Commencing tomorrow, Agents McQuaid and Walker will begin around-the-clock surveillance. Rest assured that if these two turn out to be Obsidian agents, they will both be taken care of.
Music credits. Town Theme by Space Bards. Street by Space Bards. Pink Human Cracker by Gamlet. The End.
This is Miracle Dragon saying Shroud of the Avatar rocks, thanks to Avatar Radio.
Hello everyone, this is Asclepius with a wonderful story from Andartiana entitled Odd Tidings from the Bear Tavern, a Courthouse. Background music by Smart Sound. Chapter 1. Familiar, Fairly, Forks. Beer and banter, bears they be, a peaceful world for all to see. A courthouse grand for laws to teach, erected now in Baron's reach. They, the magisters of lawful sight, call out the failures with voice of might. Sentence villains for justice, please, for law is fact-based, not endless pleas. A loud knock on the door to Dr. Zazra's bedchambers shook her awake out of a deep sleep. Dr. Zazra's yawned for a moment. Who could possibly be knocking at this hour of day? The pub of extraordinary thoughts was always open to allow scholars to read and drink, but Dr. Zazra's private chambers were always off limits. Dr. Zazra's yawned once more and said, Who is it?
Begging your pardon, Governor, but a notice from the courthouse of Baron's Reach has arrived for you. I thought it might be important, so I brought it right up.
said Glenda, the barkeep, who kept the pub running while Dr. Zazarus was away.
Very good, Glenda. Please place it on my powder table. I will come and take a look, Dr. Zazarus said.
Yes, Governor,
said Glenda, who placed the notice on Dr. Zazarus' powder table, then walked down to the bar. Dr. Zazarus slowly got up out of bed and walked out to her dressing room. The cold stone floor felt oddly refreshing on her feet as she walked. She enjoyed carpets on the floor as well, but there was something special about feeling the smooth, natural stone on her feet. Dr. Zazarus opened up her wardrobe and began pulling on her clothes. Depending on the message, she might have to change them again, but for now, she put on her normal daily wear clothes. Dr. Zazarus walked over to her powder table and picked up the letter Glenda had left for her. It was addressed simply with Governor and Artiana Zazarus on the cover. The paper was, however, very ornate, with a golden bear paw seal on the back. Dr. Zazarus had visited Baron's Reach on many occasions while travelling, so she was familiar with the people of that city. She opened the letter and began to read it.
Most Honourable Governor Andartiana Zazarus, you have been nominated by the votes of your peers to become a magistrate of the courthouse of Baron's Reach. If you accept this nomination, we invite you to visit Baron's Reach to begin the confirmation hearings, where a group of distinguished leaders from across Novia will evaluate the core of who you are and your abilities to judge fairly and impartially as a magistrate. Please address replies to the clerk of the courthouse of Baron's Reach. Signed, Asta Cerberus, clerk of the courthouse of Baron's Reach. Dr. Zazarus rolled up the note after reading it once more through. It occurred to her that it was very peculiar that a courthouse had been constructed in Baron's Reach. She had visited the courthouse on a few occasions while travelling the area. What was interesting was that the entire city of Baron's Reach had been built around the camaraderie of the Bear Tavern, which is at the heart of the city. That the tavern had spawned a courthouse would take some research for historical context for Dr. Zazarus to understand its creation. Dr. Zazarus wrote an acceptance letter, then waved her arm and summoned Fawkes. The Phoenix stared up at Dr. Zazarus with reproachful eyes.
Don't look at me with complaining eyes. I sealed the letter in a fireproof container, Dr. Zazarus said.
Fawkes squawked loudly and looked at the floor.
Yes, I know it's far and covered with snow. I'm sure you can fly over the mountains north and catch a downdraft into Baron's Reach. I will head out shortly thereafter and meet you in the city, Dr. Zazarus said.
Fawkes bowed his head, and Dr. Zazarus handed the fireproof letter container to his outstretched talon. Fawkes then shuffled down the hall and flew out a door. Chapter 2. Courthouse, chuckled, Clark. A short while after Fawkes had left, Dr. Zazarus gathered the needed supplies for the short trek to the mountain fortress of Baron's Reach. She was eager to receive more information about the process of selecting magistrates and the creation of a more unified law system across Novia. Dr. Zazarus could have waited for a reply from the court to be returned before leaving for Baron's Reach, but since she preferred to be out travelling rather than ruminating within her city's walls, she left Verat Chaos and headed north. Baron's Reach was not a long journey from Verat Chaos. A winding path north of central Brittany led up to the mountain stronghold. Halfway to the city, Fawkes flew down and landed next to Dr. Zazarus. He held out a talon with a scroll held in it.
Excellent work, Fawkes. That was faster than even I thought you could make it. Would you like a fire field to relax in while I read the letter? Dr. Zazarus asked.
Fawkes cooed happily and flew over to a nearby rock. Dr. Zazaris cast Firefield, and the circle of fire surrounded Fawkes, who then relaxed and nestled down to the rock for a nap. Dr. Zazaris opened up the fireproof scroll case and read the enclosed letter. Most Honorable Governor Andartiana Zazaris, we are pleased that you have accepted the nomination to the courthouse at Baron's Reach. At your earliest convenience, you may travel to Baron's Reach, and we can begin the process. Signed, Asta Cerberus, Clerk of the Courthouse of Baron's Reach.
Thank you, folks. It looks like I'll be heading on my way. You may follow if inclined, or return to Verat Chaos, Dr. Zazaris said.
Fawkes opened one eye, then closed it, and went back to warming himself by the fire.
Or you can just sit at the firefield until it goes out, Dr. Zazaris chuckled.
Dr. Zazaris continued her trek north. After about 10 minutes, Fawkes came into view overhead, circling in the distance. As Dr. Zazaris climbed the hills outside of Baron's Reach, she could see that Fawkes was waiting on the walls of the city. Dr. Zazaris finished climbing the hill and entered the gates of Baron's Reach. White snow was falling around, which seemed to continuously blanket the city in frost. As she neared the Bear Tavern, Dr. Zazaris saw Clark waiting by the entrance.
Greetings, Clark. I don't normally see you outside the courthouse. Are you still clerking for the court?
Dr. Zazaris asked. Governor Zazaris, you are exactly the person I was looking to see, Clark said.
Oh, do tell, Dr. Zazaris said.
I was asked by Asta Cerberus to wait for your arrival and direct you to your interview, Clark said.
Thank you, Clark. I appreciate you waiting for me, Dr. Zazaris replied.
Your meeting will be held in the courthouse on the second floor in Meeting Room A, which is on the left side. The people who will be reviewing you will be wearing masks to conceal their identities so that the judgment will be more impartial, Clark said.
Thank you, Clark. Is there any other information I need to know?
Dr. Zazaris said. I do not believe so. I will walk you to the courthouse and then Asta Cerberus will take you into the room. He is not one of the people grading you. However, he is the clerk who is overseeing the proceedings, Clark said.
Excellent. Lead the way, Clark, Dr. Zazaris said.
Clark led the way out of the central city off to the north, to where the courthouse was located. He did not talk, but simply walked in silence. When they got to the front of the courthouse, Clark directed Dr. Zazaris to enter the building, as he would be attending to other nominees who were travelling to the city as well. Dr. Zazaris thanked Clark and entered the courthouse. Chapter 3. Inviting, immediately, intimidating. Dr. Zazaris entered the courthouse and, as always, found the entrance hall to be grand and inviting. Asta Cerberus was waiting at the front desk.
Governor Zazaris, welcome to the courthouse at Baron's Reach. I am Asta Cerberus, and it is my pleasure to help with the nomination process. The Council of Nobility and leaders of Novia are waiting in the room upstairs. They will be asking you a series of questions. They will not reply directly to you, but will listen to your answers and then ask follow-up scenarios. Once this process is completed, the leaders selecting the magistrates of the Courthouse of Baron's Reach will grade you and other nominated applicants and decide who is worthy to become a magister of the Courthouse of Baron's Reach, Asta Cerberus said.
Thank you, Asta. Is this something we can start immediately, or do I need to wait for another applicant to complete? Dr. Zazaris asked.
The reviewers are not currently with an application, so they may see you immediately if you are ready, Asta Cerberus said.
I am ready. Please lead the way, Dr. Zazaris said.
Astor led Dr. Zazaris up to the second floor. He then had her wait in the hall outside the meeting room while he went through the door into the room. Through the door, Dr. Zazaris could hear muffled voices talking to each other. She waited patiently, and in about 5 minutes, Astor returned to the hall.
The reviewers are ready for you. There are several of them sitting around the room. As Clark should have told you, their identities have been concealed so that they receive no pressure in the choice they are about to make. You will be asked a series of questions. There are no wrong answers, so answer as truthfully and thoughtfully as you can. When you are ready, simply walk through the door and take a seat, Astor Cerberus said.
Thank you, Astor, Dr. Zazaris said.
Dr. Zazaris walked toward the meeting room door. She was not nervous at all. Having faced dragons and demons, a room full of bureaucrats was not at all intimidating. The room was not particularly large. A round table was on the right side, and the various leaders were in chairs around it. There was a blue chair by the fire. Dr. Zazaris walked over to the chair and took a seat. The people around the table all turned towards her.
Greetings, Governor Zazaris. We have heard many wonderful things about you. We are so glad that you accepted the nomination to be considered for a position as a magistrate. We will begin this interview process by asking you some questions. If you are ready, you can begin, one of the reviewers said.
Thank you. And thank you to all the reviewers who are helping in this process. You may proceed with the questions, Dr. Zazaris said.
A woman's voice chimed in from one of the reviewers.
We are going to begin by telling you a scenario and then asking you questions about it. This is the first scenario. It is your day to take the bench, and a new case is to be heard this morning. As you are reading over the documents, you hear the door open as the claimants begin to enter the courtroom. First is the defendant, Dinzu, of the Moongate Travellers. You have heard of him as an upstanding citizen of New Britannia, always looking out for others and putting every effort in to help whenever and whomever they may, newcomer and old alike. Next to enter the courtroom is the plaintiff, Baron Drokus F. of Rat's Nest. He is also known throughout the land, but you have heard of him in other circles for quite a different reason. He's outspoken to the point that some see him as argumentative and taking pleasure in causing disruption. Reading over the case, as you prepare to hear arguments, you have questions of legitimacy flooding your mind. The charge is as follows. Baron Drokus has charged Dinsu with biting him in an attempt to eat him. As everyone rises to be sworn in, you take your seat.
One of the other reviewers then chimed in. Now that you have heard the scenario, here are the questions we would like you to answer. How do you feel about seeing these two enter your courtroom? And whom do you rule in favour of, and why? Dr. Zazaris thought for a moment and then replied,
On the first question, I have no specific prejudices towards either party. Regardless of how good or bad a person seems to society as a whole, the facts of the case are the only things that matter. I would need to look for motive, such as what caused the defendant to bite the plaintiff. Were there mitigating circumstances? What is the law regarding biting and eating a person? The only reason I would question legitimacy would be if an action is not against the law, does not have evidence to support the charges, or does not have standing to sue, as in a third-party person who was not involved. In these cases, the defendant could move for a dismissal, and I would agree. On the second question, with the limited information that has been provided, I could not rule for either party. I would need a lot more details. Being a magistrate, you can't really assume anything.
I can't assume that biting is against the law in a specific area. It is entirely possible the parties were engaged in an open combat situation where biting would be acceptable. Likewise, the charge of cannibalism is also not illegal everywhere. There are cultures where eating dead relatives is considered an honour for both the dead and the living as they become part of each other.
Thank you, Governor Zazaris, for answering our questions. We will review your answers over the next few days, and if you are selected to continue the interview process, we will summon you again. You may wait in rooms provided in Baron's Reach, one of the reviewers said.
Thank you for your time. I look forward to hearing from you, Dr. Zazaris said.
Echoes from the Caverns is brought to you by Lord Baldrith, Asclepius, and Sir Style Tekel. Also brought to you by Avatars Radio.
Hello everyone, this is Asclepius, with the next chapter in this wonderful story by Ulfhedir, entitled The Pilgrimage of Virtue. Background music by Smart Sound. Chapter 7, Resolute to Virtus. We stayed in Resolute for a few more days while we discussed our options for the next leg of the pilgrimage. The morning before the day we left, I went to the Bell of Courage devotional and sat at the edge of the fountain. I was reflecting on what it meant to be courageous and what the soldier did in the pass when the elder slowly walked up and joined me. "This has been a good journey, has it not?" he said, slowly leaning on the fountain. "We are not yet halfway, and already one of us almost died," I replied. The elder nodded slowly, but did not look remorseful. The farmer, noticing us, walked over to join us. "The world is not a safe place. It never was, and it never will be," the elder said. "But isn't that what the Outlanders are here for? To make this place safe again?" the farmer asked. The elder looked up, taking a slow breath. He watched as the shattered moon began to set. "Make it better," he said slowly. "Fix what was broken. Help us. Perhaps. But they will never make a safe world. Such a thing does not exist. It cannot exist," the elder said. In a slow motion, he turned, deliberately, and looked up at the carved bell above us. "They don't seem to suggest they will fix everything. They teach courage. Courage to leave the places we know and journey to places we have never been. And there is danger in that. If they were going to make us all safe, they would never need to teach us courage." When we got back to the inn, the plan to leave South Paladus was shared. We would head west and make our way through Virtus Pass. Our next stop for provisions would be Virtus. Many thought it was a dangerous plan. The elves of Virtus may not want us there. There is rumour that the elves have been quite violent recently. The rumour started an argument, and we all reconsidered the safety of our pilgrimage. We did finally agree that if we were serious about the virtues, we would need to have the courage to continue. Unlike Nightshade Pass, Virtus Pass wound up into the mountains and was known to be quite cold. There was talk of bears, wolves, and elves on the pass. If the animals didn't kill us, maybe the elves would. And if not that, then the cold. It may be foolhardy, but we had courage. Maybe it was the actions of the soldier, or the fact that we were in Resolute, with the Bell of Courage and the Statue of Granus. But we all agreed that we would take this dangerous leg of the journey. We arrived at the base of the pass before nightfall. We were already frozen. We built a fire huddled together under blankets, and were spent. Our bodies shook in an attempt to warm us. No stories were shared that night. We were 9 frozen, achy travellers who awoke and ascended into the Virtus Pass that morning. Even though we were tired and cold, we needed our wits about us. The pass was populated by hungry animals. Just breaking in here, you have 15 minutes remaining until the end of the show to get over here to Immortal City, to the Avatars Radio Studio, meet up with Elaine Dragonfire, open a trade window with her, and you will receive a streamer bundle. How awesome is that? Okay, so tune into us, get over here in the next 15 minutes for our final giveaway, and you get a streamer bundle absolutely for free. Do it. Luckily, we only encountered the wolves. I doubt it was the worst thing we could encounter, and I don't think we would want to encounter anything else. They were very large, hungry wolves, and when they ran, they were incredibly fast. I did not imagine that such an animal could be that fast. We bested them with raw meats that were purchased in Resolute, throwing them at the wolves, feeding them with meat rather than our own flesh. Don't run, the soldier reminded us, as we moved as quickly away from the wolves as we could without running. After the wolves, we thought we would have much more danger, but all we met was the cold snow. It was very cold, colder than the night before. We were scared for our lives, but the warmth of danger kept us going. The snow got worse as we continued. It fell so fast and plentiful that we could not see much ahead of us. The tailor suggested by yelling over the cold wind that we slow down and grab a hold of the person ahead of us and slowly walk forward. We wouldn't need to rely on our sight, which was a relief, as we could bend our heads against the wind and snow. It all relied on our leader, which I couldn't be bothered to look to see who it was. I do not know which path we took. My eyes were on the white ground beneath me or the smith's fur coat ahead of me. I grasped the end of a scarf or belt that flew behind her. It was awful and cold, the wind flying through our furs and leathers and seeping into our very hearts. The only benefit that I could think of was that any animal or elf that wanted to do us harm would also have to deal with the cold. I write now on the other side of the pass, warmed by a large fire and blankets. We sat around, each of us in a daze, the ice and snow still melting from our furs.
How did we manage to survive that?
The scholar asked. Strength, the soldier said, as he was rubbing his healing arm. Determination, the cook said. We didn't want to die up there. Because we had each other, the tailor said. We all wanted each other to survive, so we went beyond what we would normally do, so that others would survive also. The elder nodded and smiled. All true, all true. We relied on each other's strength and determination. What a team we are. There were some smiles that went around the campfire then. The cook handed out the stew. It was a cold night, but we slept comfortably. The snows and winds of Virtus Pass were behind us, and we slept in our bedrolls near a well-stoked fire. There was some trepidation about our next step. There were the rumours about the elves that we now had to face. We didn't want to venture to Virtus and be shot on sight. They are savage, or so I've heard, the smith said. They have attacked cities, caravans, and travellers, the sailor said. I'd be more comfortable just staying in the wild until we get somewhere else.
You are applying the actions of some to the whole, the scholar said. I'm sure the same could be said about humans.
We've attacked the elves and the kobolds, but that doesn't mean we would kill a kobold or elf suddenly if we met one. That is true, the farmer spoke softly. I've heard the Virtus elves are quite nice. All they want is to learn about truth. It sounds quite noble.
We are not a war party, the tailor pointed out. We are on a pilgrimage, and we want to learn about the virtues. If they do want to learn about truth, then we seek the same thing. We arrived in Virtus the next afternoon, and were stopped by a pair of guards who asked us what our intentions were. There was a long pause before anyone spoke. The scholar spoke then, explaining very succinctly that we were on a pilgrimage to explore the virtues. Seemingly content, the two guards nodded their grey heads at each other and showed us into the town. Virtus is a beautiful place filled with life. Although it is a cold town covered in snow, the streets are lined with fragrant, flowering trees and bushes. There was care and love built into everything here. It was a surprisingly beautiful town. The elves themselves were aloof but pleasant. They were very curious about our pilgrimage and asked us many questions. We seek to learn about the virtues, the elder explained. But instead of sitting around and talking, debating their importance, we decided to explore, to walk the land and see this world, and learn about the virtues firsthand. There is wisdom in your actions, an important-looking elf said. Our kind is exploring the virtues as well, but in a different way. We look inward, trying to find meaning in our existence. Isn't that what all living things yearn for? The elder replied. The two seemed to get along quite well. They spoke at great length together, discussing philosophy and other deep topics that I could not follow or do justice on paper.
Hey, laddie! Is that Avatar's radio you're playing there?
Yes.
Well, crank it up, laddie!
Avatar's radio. Radio for the Avatar.
We now present our second play, entitled Regulations. Written by Womby. Produced and directed by Asclepius. Director of Public Relations, Amber Rain. Cast: Lord Baldrith as the narrator and Official 1. Asclepius as Official 2. Music by Smart Sound.
Few people are aware of the thankless tasks carried out by our loyal public administrators. Let us take a moment to listen in to two such faithful public servants as they go about their daily duties in a back room somewhere in Owl's Head. I hate this job.
You say that every day.
That's because it's true every day. Take the case of this weirdo south of the river.
What weirdo?
You know, that drunkard who built a memorial eyesore out of the wardrobes and giant chessboards on his village lot. He even has a hot tub in there somewhere.
Oh, yes. I remember processing all those public complaints. If I recall correctly, I sent an inspector down there to order him to take it down. What happened with that?
The inspector returned with a message and then promptly quit. Said he'd had better things to do with his life.
That's odd. What was the message?
It's a statement.
Okay, what was the statement?
No, that's what the message said. It said, and I quote, "It's a statement."
It's a statement? It's a freaking statement? This
unemployed drunkard builds a house out of giant chessboards balanced on wardrobes, violating every city ordinance and construction regulation in the book, and all he has to say for himself is, it's a statement.
Well, he has a point.
What do you mean he has a point?
Have you seen the number of identical buildings springing up? It's these avatars. They turn up, disappear for a week, and then suddenly they have a plot of land with the most expensive building possible on it. It's suspicious, it's unfair, and it's downright nauseating.
Look, I'm not saying I disagree with you, but regulations are regulations. Who knows where such chaos will lead? Did you issue him with a summons?
Nope.
Why not?
I didn't issue him a summons because he wasn't doing anything wrong. While doing research to fill in the appropriate paperwork, I discovered that his plot is zoned as parks and residential.
So?
Well, it turns out he has officially declared that his lot is a park, and his structure is a sculpture celebrating the inventor of beer. He has generously donated his sculpture to the city, but is now claiming the annual artist's grant for public works. The one that nobody else has applied for this year.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes. We have no choice but to award it to him since he is the only applicant. That isn't all, however. In fact, here's where it gets really interesting. The city is legally obligated to appoint guards to patrol all public structures, and that includes his sculpture, which is now owned by the city.
A costly nuisance, yes. But why is that interesting?
Our drunken friend has applied for the job to guard his sculpture.
That crafty devil. The rules force us to award the position to the person best suited for the job. And since he lives inside the sculpture, he's the obvious choice.
Exactly. Want to knock off early today? I could do with a drink.
Absolutely. And with that stellar example of bureaucracy at work, that concludes Podcasts and Poetry for today. Thanks everybody for tuning in. Thank you for joining us and for following along. It is wonderful to have you here. And also congratulations to our winners of today, Teresa Pyle, Tamer Afek, and Ran Agier. And I hope I pronounced those halfway correctly. But this is what we do here. We give away stuff. And all you have to do is tune in, find us in Immortal City, and every half hour, I believe, we'll be giving away a streamer bundle. So don't forget to tune in for future live streams for your chance to win. And not only that, the live streams are incredibly entertaining as well. Okay, as always, look after yourselves. Have a great week. Stay safe. I'll be back next week with the music show. And hope to see you then. So long, everybody.